right, good evening, Crossroads. Let's stand and worship together.
Love endures through generations. world that you are constant for us. You are the same then, now, and forever. And we thank you that you love us and keep us under your protection constantly. We thank you for coming here and being with us tonight. In your name we pray. Well, welcome to Thursday night service. Since you're all standing, why don't you turn and greet one another?
Well, hello, everyone. Welcome to Crossroads. Woo, right? I love Thursday nights. So my name is Glow, and if you are joining us online, a big welcome to you. If you are new, hello. So everyone, if you have any questions during service, all you have to do is scan that QR code right at your seat back or up on the screen, and we would love to connect with you in any way and answer any questions that you may have. So I am happy because we have so many events going on. So ladies, tomorrow is women's worship, right? So we're gonna have a bunch of ladies together right here tomorrow at 6:30. Bring your friends, bring your family, bring your neighbors, and we get to just connect with God and women just from all over, and it's a special night for the ladies. Now, the next one is Love Manteca. So that is Saturday. So tonight's the last night for you to sign up, so please look up on our website, lovemanteca.com, and sign up for anything that interests you. And you know what? Nothing is too small, nothing is too great, and we would love to see you there on Saturday, 8 a.m. at Northgate Park, and I promise you, the 3 hours of work that you do will go a long ways for our community. Now, this other one, we are partnering with Kids Against Hunger. So those of you that did it last year, we're bringing it back, and I'd like to introduce you to a video, and it shows you what you're gonna do and how your help helps. So go ahead and roll that.
Look down from a broken sky, traced out by the city lights. My world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight. Touch down in the cold black top, hold on for the sudden stop. Breathing the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes, Lord, give me your eyes so I can see. For everything that I keep missing. Give me your heart for the broken hearted. Give me your heart.
It's going to Haiti this year. That's amazing. So one of those bags actually feeds 6 people. And last year we had a goal of doing 5,000 meals. We actually did 40,000 meals. So together we are strong. So that event is on May 19th. And it's going to be here at 2 o'clock, so sign up because those spots go fast. And you can sign up at crossroadsgrace.org/hunger. Now, without further ado, we are back in the series of David. So, hey, Pastor B is going to come up and tag you're it, and thank you for joining us at Crossroads.
So intimidating, right? Just a heartbeat. My goodness, man. Hey, glad to have you guys here this evening. My name is Pastor Brian, and I'm so glad that you're with us here today. Whether you're joining us here in Manteca, you're joining us online, I want to welcome you. And then also let you know that our mission statement has not changed. It is that we exist to lead everyone to discover Jesus and follow him fully. And what that means is that we just want you to have at least one person in your life that you're praying for, you're connecting with, you're sharing Jesus with, so that they could discover Jesus, follow Jesus, and then lead somebody to do the very same thing. So that's why we're here. I want to help you take whatever step that might mean for you. And if you're joining us online, wherever you're at, we want the same thing for you. The chat host is going to be available for you right now. If you need anything, they're going to chat with you, pray with you, anything you need, make sure you reach out. But before I dive in today, guys, I just want to celebrate some really cool things that have been happening around here and remind us about this journey that we're on as a church. And the journey that I'm referring to is called Unstoppable. It's a two-year generosity journey that we are trying to reach more people for Jesus through really three targeted areas. And the first is that we want to reach everyone, which means we want to continue to reach the Central Valley for Jesus and even look to plant another campus for a Crossroads campus. We also want to unleash our future, which means we want to eliminate, if not reduce, our debt altogether as a church. And then finally, we want to navigate life together. And that means we're preparing to open the very first Crossroads Counseling Center to help people with their hurts, habits, and hangups along the way to be able to be Jesus to them. And our journey is a two-year commitment, and we just want to see more people know who Jesus is. And that's why we wanted to share with you some of the amazing baptism stories that we saw from this Easter. And you might remember that we had this baptism weekend at Easter and then a baptism celebration that happened right after that to help people take some practical steps in their walk with Jesus. We captured a few of their stories for you, wanted you to see it, and also recap the 159 people that were baptized as a reminder of our unstoppable God. So take a look at this video, super cool.
I know that you can do anything and no one can stop you. God is unstoppable. Jesus says his church is unstoppable. So if we believe this is true, then what's holding us back from being unstoppable for God in our life? The answer should be nothing. The more we trust Jesus, the more we believe that his way is the best way, his kingdom is the best kingdom, his love is the best love, and everything else then becomes secondary to that. It's then that we believe that whatever God calls us as a church to do next, our unstoppable God is worth following him towards it.
I chose to get baptized because in a world that's full of uncertainty and darkness, I needed something. I needed light. And I knew that God existed, but I didn't have a relationship with him. And I truly do believe now that I'm not alone, that he is with me. He will always be with me. And he's the hope that I needed. And he's rebuilding me from the ground up, literally from the studs. And I'm accepting it every which way. It took me 30 years to accept it, but I'm finally accepting it now. And I really do feel it changing me for the better.
With my grandpa's passing last year, it did bring me to a deep level in my life. And I wanted to restore everything and become closer to God in order to have access to heaven once I am ready to go, and to spread the word again with everyone else who surrounds me, and also spread the word through school and through all my leadership things that I do.
I was going through life feeling very like unfulfilled, like something was missing. And I think that also like going through so many challenges, you know, financially, mentally, emotionally, and getting through them, like breaking through them, I realized like I couldn't do it by myself, and there was no way that I did it on my own.
In December 23, I decided to rededicate my life to Jesus. 2 days before I had my anniversary of having over 2 years in recovery, and then I decided that it was time for me to get baptized after my daughter looked at me and she's like, Mom, you need to get baptized.
I felt like it was calling. I just felt like I had to do it because, the Lord's everything. He created us. He is the one true God.
Man. Hey, that's so cool. And listen, that was just a sprinkling of the stories that are out there. But I'm just proud that you're part of helping people take their next step forward. And all of you that took your step of faith, we're here for you. We want to continue to walk with you. But man, if you're ready, if you want to be part of that and make a step forward in your faith and get baptized, June 27th and 30th, we have another service. We're going to be doing baptisms. If you're ready, you can go on and you can click on that website. You can go right there on the app or wherever. You can register to let us know that you're going to be coming. But June 27th, 30th is your chance to take your next step. But I also just want to say thank you. If you are part of this unstoppable journey with us, you are making a difference in the lives of people throughout the Central Valley on what's happening through Crossroads. And I'm excited to continue to give you lots of updates as things are kind of going, but you're part of something bigger than yourself, something God-sized, and I think that's truly worth your effort and your sacrifice. So thank you so much. But this week, we're going to continue. We're going to jump back into our series on David after we pushed pause last week to reflect on some things that we needed to look in our life and then also some things that we were looking at in the life of our church. And if you missed that message, I would just encourage you, highly encourage you to go check that out this week. Give yourself permission to push pause on life and listen to that. And you can get more information at the app or on our website. We'd love for you to go there. But as we dive back into the series on David, I just want to do a brief summary, kind of pull us up to speed so we're all on the same page. And in week one, we started off the series by looking at how God's original design was for him to lead us directly. But God's people, we kind of got tired of him. And instead we said, hey, you know what? I want my own king. I want a king. And so in 1 Samuel chapter 8, they're speaking to this prophet named Samuel. And they said to him, you are old and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us such as all the other nations have. So what God did is he allowed them to choose a king over him. And as a result, they chose King Saul. He was crowned the very first king of Israel. And Saul, he was the stereotypical vision that you would have for a king, and even what he looked like. So 1 Samuel chapter 9, it would say, Kish had a son named Saul, as handsome a young man as could be found anywhere in Israel, and he was a head taller than anyone else. But despite the outward appearance, what he looked like on the outside, his insides didn't match up. And Saul very quickly lost favor with God. And because of his sinful decisions, God chose to select a new king to replace Saul. And this king would be different, not just in stature, in looks, but in what mattered the most, in his heart. And so in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, we read that the Lord does not look at things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart, which is why this new king would have a new heart. And so in 1 Samuel 13, we read about this new king. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him the ruler of his people. And the one that God chose was not the oldest, the brightest, the smartest, the tallest, because that was the standard for leadership at the time, usually the oldest, but he actually chose the youngest of all the sons of Jesse, a young man by the name of David. And this unknown sheepherder was anointed by God, the future king of Israel. And I say future because Saul, he was still the king, and this whole transition was going to take a long time to happen, as we'll kind of see play out today. But David bursts onto the scene with a battle with a 9-foot-tall giant Philistine warrior named Goliath. And as the people of God camped across from the army of the Philistines, there was a valley between them, a daily battle line was drawn between Goliath and anyone the people of God wanted to bring out to fight him. Mano a mano, right? A fight to the death, a victory among all victories. And so day after day, the Goliath would stand up and he would call people out. That was until one day, and during an Uber, like an Uber Eats delivery that David was doing for his brothers, he steps up to the challenge. He's like, no, I'll take on this Goliath, dude. And so David, he arms himself with a single slingshot, five smooth stones that he got from a local river, a local stream, and he confidently walked into the middle of that battlefield. But little did Goliath know, this was an unfair fight. Because it wasn't just this small shepherd boy, David, he was fighting. He was fighting the Almighty God, too. And in 1 Samuel chapter 17, we get to read what David's words actually are. It said this in 1 Samuel chapter 17. It would say this, David's famous words. He says, David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. So David doesn't retreat. He advances toward Goliath. He knocks him down with a single stone that blows, hits him right in the head. And after David is done doing that, he finishes the job. So in verse 50, we read a little bit more. It says, so David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, with a sword in his hand. He struck down the Philistine and killed him. David ran and stood over him. He took hold of the Philistine's sword, drew it from the sheath. After he killed him, he cut off his head with a sword. So this is where we left off with little old David. And if you're not ready to like run through a brick wall right now, y'all better check your pulse, because that was insane. It was intense, because that was next level fire stuff going on right there. Because David just moved out of the shadows of obscurity, and now he's in the limelight of national fame. But what we really, really, really want to see, we want to see if something got overshadowed in the novelty of that moment. See, we want to see the condition of David's heart. Is he, in fact, a someone that is after God's own heart? And if so, how do we know? I mean, killing a giant, it's one thing, but that could have just meant that he had a brave heart. And lots of people have brave moments. The same is true for us. Because lots of us can say we have a heart that beats for God every now and again, right? Like we could say the prayer at Thanksgiving meal once a year. Does that mean that our heart beats for God? You can post a Bible verse on your Instagram, or even take a picture of you having your yearly quiet time at the fireplace. Does that mean that your heart beats for God? You could volunteer at the gospel mission, but does that really mean your heart beats for God? Because let's be very honest, there is a difference between a heart that beats for God and a heart that skips a beat for God. Now, I'm not talking about when you saw that cute boy in junior high, or when you saw your wife walking down the aisle, like that kind of skipped the beat. Now, that's good stuff. But what I'm talking about here is that extra beat that isn't normal. A heart that has a skipped beat for God is kind of an abnormality to your life. It's not your normal heart rhythm. It's a fluke. It's an accident. It's a cardiac hiccup, which means that soon your heart will go back to the rhythm of selfishness and apathy and laziness towards God. After all, it was just a moment. It was a hiccup. It's not going to really last. But a heart that beats for God, it's constantly in the rhythm of God in all areas of your life. It's not a fluke. It's actually intentional. And the heart that is intentionally beating for God is one that longs for only what he wants in your life over anything else. But that type of heart will always come in conflict with the world. Because the world, you might not know this, the world wants your heart to be dissatisfied. It wants you to be constantly looking for the next thing, knowing that the only thing that will satisfy you is Jesus. But it wants you to forget about that and think about what the world wants. And there are times that we might think that we found what our heart wants. You maybe it's the job, or maybe it's the addiction, or it's the hobby, or maybe that person, or that the cause that you're involved with. And when that happens, what we do is we start to identify ourselves with those things, which then causes us to have to defend whatever it is that we've identified ourselves more than anything else, with everything that we have. And anything, and I mean anything that threatens that identity, we have to neutralize, because we have to protect our hearts so it continues to beat for that thing. We see clearly that this is with David and Saul today. You're going to see it come in perfect focus. In fact, look at what happens almost immediately following this literal Goliath moment with David. Look at what it says in verse 57. It says, as soon as David returned from killing the Philistine, that's Goliath, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with David still holding the Philistine's head. Can you imagine that? David probably out of breath, just pumped up, adrenaline, you know, veins popping, just doesn't know what he's doing. He's holding the head of Goliath in his hand. Like, that's an amazing moment. But little did Saul know that would mark the beginning of David's victorious path to the crown that currently sat on Saul's head. See, look at 1 Samuel 18, look in verse 5. It says, whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high rank in the army. This pleased all the troops and Saul's officers as well. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing with joyful songs and with timbrels and lyres. As they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands. David is tearing it up, y'all. But Saul, he's not happy because all the fanfare is going to David and it's not getting to him. So in verse 8, it makes sense. It says, Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, but he thought, but me with only thousands? What more can he get but the kingdom? And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. Saul's heart was turning jealous towards David, this little David fellow, and he was stealing his identity and his glory from him, which makes perfect sense that what we would read in verse 12 would take place. Because in verse 12 it says, Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David but had departed from Saul. So he sent David away from him and gave him command over 1,000 men, and David led the troops in their campaigns. In everything he did, he had great success, but the Lord was with him. When Saul saw how successful he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he led them in their campaigns. Jump down to verse 30, it gets even better. It says the Philistine commanders continued to go to battle, out to battle. And as often as they did, David met them with more success than the rest of Saul's officers. And his name became well known. He was famous. Very reminiscent of when David was up against Goliath, wasn't it? Because when God is on your side, you can't lose. And David is firmly in the favor of God in every way imaginable. And so he just keeps on winning and winning and winning. And Saul keeps on getting more and more mad and furious that this is happening. Because Saul is losing his identity. Now, let's be honest. No one likes it when someone takes their job. Right? You know, like I've never met anybody that's like super duper thrilled when they got fired and that new employee took over their job that they just had. Never met them. Or when the company hires a bunch of new salesmen to kind of light a fire under everybody else and makes everything cutthroat. No. Ain't a good thing. Usually causes those intense feelings of jealousy. There's some fear that wells up inside you, doesn't it? I remember when I was playing baseball, the higher up you played in the sport, the more cutthroat and divisive it became. Your closest friends on the baseball team were not the guys that you had the same position at. No. You were competing with them. You always had to have friends with the other players that were other positions because they weren't threats to you. Because in college, if they take your spot, you lose your scholarship. And when you start playing professionally and you start getting a paycheck for that, that person's not taking your spot. It means your family doesn't eat or you don't get to pay your rent. So it's natural when someone is threatening to take your job that you'd be a little defensive. But there's also something that's happening on a heart level. It's not only a threat to your employment, but you know what it is? It's a threat to your identity. Because our heart tells us, who would you be if you're not what you're doing right now? See, what happens when your kids all graduate and you're not the PTA president anymore? What do you do when you don't get the part for the play after you practice so much? Who are you when retirement comes and then Monday you don't have to fight the Altamont traffic anymore? Like, who are you? See, King Saul knows that feeling. He had lost the favor of God in his life. But instead of owning up to his mistakes, saying, I screwed up, going back and falling back in line with God, Saul decides he's going to blame David because he's the one gaining all the favor and all the blessing in God, so it's his fault. His heart was turning from God so quickly. It was becoming something that was cold and it was hard and it was jealous and nothing less than the destruction of David entirely could solve it because he thought David was the problem, not his sin. You ever caught that happening in your life? Has your heart like turned cold toward your spouse because you've started to believe that, man, I deserve better, or that they're not enough for me anymore? Has your heart become jealous of what other people have and you can't appreciate what you've been given? Have you watched so much political commentary that your heart is so hardened to hear anybody else's different viewpoint? Is your heart cynical? And so you always see the worst in people instead of the best? It can happen to all of us if we're not careful. It really can. And what's at the core of this heart change is the need for the world to revolve around what we want, isn't it? That's what happened to Saul. David was encroaching on his identity, and so he felt there's only one thing I got to do. I got to get rid of this David kid. And so that's what he attempted to do. Tried to murder him twice with a spear at point-blank range. That didn't work. He tried to have him killed in battles against the Philistines. He actually tried to kill him in his own bed, but David's wife, which was Saul's daughter, that makes things spicy, helped him escape. So David knew that sticking around where he was at was not a good thing. So he got on the lam. He ran away from Saul, and Saul would not quit. He continued to pursue David everywhere, and he would follow him from town to town and village to village, even cave to cave. And for a short moment, Saul would leave his pursuit of David, and he would go fight the Philistines so his kingdom wouldn't get lost. But Saul never was deterred. Even after fighting all those battles, he still got right on. He's like, I got to find David, and I couldn't get him out of my mind. And so that's where we pick up. 1 Samuel chapter 24, we jump to this. It says, after Saul returned from pursuing the Philistines, he was told, David is in the desert of En-Gedi. So Saul took 3,000 able young men from all Israel and set out to look for David and his men near the crags of the wild goats. Saul was so bent on getting David that he brought 3,000 men to get one dude. Overkill, much, right? Are we good? Yeah, now let's think about this logically for just a second. David had done nothing wrong. He hasn't harmed Saul in any way. In fact, he had helped Saul immensely by fighting all these battles and bringing victory after victory to him. Yet Saul's still trying to kill him time and time again. 13 different times it turned out he would try to kill David. So David has to be, and frankly, rightfully so, a little ticked off, right? A little afraid. Like, what did I do, dude? I mean, when a king brings 3,000 men for you, you probably would be a little knee-knocking at some point, you know? I'd probably want to get back at that guy a little bit, you know? I mean, you can only push somebody's button so long until, man, they snap, and it's go time, which is why what happens next is so powerful in the story. Now, before I read it to you, you need to understand a few things. You need to understand the place that this is taking place in. The Bible just told us that it was in the desert of En-Gedi. Now, in the desert of En-Gedi, it's right off the Dead Sea, just south of Jerusalem and Jericho. If you look at it, you can see it's kind of like the crags and all that good stuff. That's the Dead Sea way over there. It kind of looks desertness. But the next picture will show you some of the caves that you might see in that area. It's very like Star Wars-esque, isn't it? It's just very harsh. But in the middle of it, though, are these En-Gedis, these oases, which you'll be able to see next. These waterfalls coming out of nowhere. There's beautiful things out of there. And that's where these goats would come to get water and everything. And if you get a little closer, you'll notice that some of the caves look kind of like this. If you get really close, you're able to get inside and kind of get in the back and kind of hide yourself in it, right in the middle of En-Gedi. So David and his men knew that this terrain in the desert of En-Gedi would be difficult, but it would be a perfect place to hide from Saul. And so you have to imagine, right? David's small army of about 600 or so men at this time, they hear 3,000 of Saul's men coming towards them. They hear this. And so in verse 3, we read this. It says, he came to the sheep pens along the way. A cave was there. And Saul went in to relieve himself. David and his men were far back in the cave. So again, picture this, okay? These men, these 600 men, scared of their lives, right? They hide in a cave. They squeeze themselves up against the wall, trying to become invisible or blending in with the sides of the rocks as much as they can. They're not even breathing. And then look who decides to come in on a royal potty break. Ha! King Saul, right there. I mean, these dudes were floored. A little grossed out, yes, but floored. They couldn't believe it. Is that Saul doing, right, you know. And so the men see this, and then we read in verse 4. Verse 4, it says, the men said, this is the day the Lord spoke of when he said to you, I will give your enemy into your hands for you to deal with as you wish. This is it. But this is the moment. This is where the power shifts from Saul to David in the middle of a cave latrine. This is what's going to happen. Makes perfect sense. But before we get too far ahead of ourselves, I just wonder if David might have had a flashback moment in that cave. A moment back to when he was in that valley and he was hearing about this Goliath guy for the very first time. That as he brought the food to his brothers, he started to talk to the other soldiers and about this Philistine who dared to taunt the army of God. And I wonder if his brother's words didn't just play out in his head a little bit. We'll look back and see what he said, actually. If you look back, this is what David's brother said. When Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him and asked, why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. He says, I know how conceited you are. I know how wicked your heart is, David boy. Now, hold on a second, because you probably are thinking the same thing I am. Hey, didn't we start this whole thing off by saying David was different? Like, didn't we say his heart was better than Saul's? How come all of a sudden we're talking about being wicked and conceited? You know what? That's probably just his older brother, a little jealous, trying to take a shot at his little brother. Like, it's more that, right? Well, I just want you to notice something. And this hit me square between the eyes like that little rock that David hit Goliath with as I was wrangling this message to the ground. And I want us to look back in 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 14. And again, we read this a few minutes ago, and we're describing David, and there it said this. It said, the Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him ruler of his people. It's David, right? But I want you to consider something for just a moment. When David fought Goliath, he was no more than 16 years old, which meant that he led Saul's army as a teenager. David was on the run from Saul for his life for about 7 years, which meant that he was just a small, in his early 20s. So do you see it yet? David wasn't a man yet. He was becoming a man. God had to take David from the shepherd to the king, from a boy to a man, but he didn't do it in a throne room. He didn't do it in a classroom. He didn't even do it on a battlefield. It happened in the wilderness. It was in the rough and the rugged real world. It's in that place where your faith is not safely placed on the shelf in a glass case, only to be dusted off to come to Thursday night service or Sunday service or maybe an occasional holiday. But instead, it is thrust into the real world of life. David's heart was being shaped to long for God in the wilderness. You didn't want to hear that today, did you? Because deep down, you were hoping that you could learn to have the heartbeat of God by coming to a church service every now and again. Maybe praying when you get in trouble before a test. in the middle of a worship song that randomly comes on your radio in the car, or maybe just through giving a little bit more at church, that'll do it. I'm afraid that's not what's going to shock your heart into a godly rhythm. Only the wilderness will bring you to the point that you come face to face with who you are and who God is to you. It happens when the kids that you love so much don't turn out the way that you raised them. It's when the dream school that you wanted to get into says that you're not a right fit. It's when you're single and you deeply want to be married. It's when your health fails and this next season of life is going to be really hard. Those and 1,000 other examples of wilderness moments are where your faith is brought to the surface and God says, what are you going to do now? Will your heart trust me or you're going to trust yourself? Will your faith flex or is it going to wilt? What happens between you and God in the wilderness will determine what will happen to your heart. And guys, that doesn't mean that you smile and you say, amen, brother, to every terrible, hard thing that comes your way. David himself in the Psalms would cry out to God with some really hard questions for him in the middle of the pain, in the middle of the wilderness. But what happens that is most important is what happens when you come out of it. What are you letting God shape in you in the middle of really hard moments? Last 3 years for me have really been wilderness moments for me and God. I'll be honest with you. My faith has been stretched in ways I can't even describe to you. I've been confused. I have been frustrated. I have been let down. I've thought God was saying one thing to go this direction, then he slaps me in the face time and time again and says, nope, that wasn't it at all. And I prayed, and I felt like it's just hit some glass ceilings. I've been in the wilderness a lot, it seems. So listen, I get it, okay? Pastors, we wrestle with it too. But we have to meet God in the wilderness so our hearts can truly beat for him. See, David's in the wilderness, surrounded by soldiers. He's been running for years at this point. And his men, they are scared to death. They are outnumbered 5-1. And now Saul, their mortal enemy, the one that has been causing all this problem, their enemy stands feet from them, ripe for the picking in that cave. This would be such an easy way to become king. He could kill Saul. He could bring out his head just like he did with Goliath. The whole thing would be over. His men would be behind him. This is a slam dunk. This is what you got to do, David. Just take him out. So what does he do? Then David crept up unnoticed and cut off a corner of Saul's robe. You did what? David, no, you missed it. You missed it. We're not trimming his robe, right? This isn't souvenir time. This is take out Saul and let's be king time. But David knew this wasn't the heartbeat of God. God was going to give him the throne. He didn't have to take it. And so he had to have restraint. And he waited for the Lord's timing. He was a young man of integrity that was developing the heart of God. And to take it even a little bit further, after Saul left that cave, do you know that David snuck out of that cave with his little souvenir robe piece with him, and he yells at those 3,000 soldiers and Saul? Check it out. Look at verse 8. Look at verse 8. It says this. Oh, man, I know it says something. Well, it's got to say something. Here we got to come back. Here we go. It says, and David went out of the cave. He called out to Saul, my lord, the king. When Saul looked behind him, David bowed down and prostrated himself with his face to the ground. He said to Saul, why do you listen when men say David is bent on harming you? This day you have seen with your own eyes how the Lord delivered you into my hands in the cave. Some urged me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not lay my hand on my lord because he is the Lord's anointed. And I believe that is the moment where David went from boy to man. It was when he was in the wilderness. He was under attack, but he didn't let the opposition change his heart. He didn't run from God, he ran to God. You see, Saul, he was running on a heart of fear, far from God, disconnected from God's spirit. He had lost sight of his identity, and the outpouring of that empty spirit was hatred and fear and anger and murder. David did not have this happen to him. His heart was for God. God's spirit was within him, and he was letting God guide him. David's identity was completely found in God, and it let him see things clearly. He wasn't blinded by rage. He was propelled forward by God's call on his life. David did not lose sight of the bigger plan that God had for him. Kept his eyes focused on the bigger plan. He kept his heart on what God wanted and not what he wanted. And he said, not for an instant am I going to go for the instant gratification. I want what's eternal. Which is really what I want you to focus on. See, the thing is that a heart beating for God doesn't sacrifice God's future blessing for instant gratification. David wasn't going to sacrifice the future blessing of the throne for the instant gratification of killing Saul quickly. He told himself, no. He was patient. He waited for the blessing. Oh, my friends, I want the same thing for you. And I know that in our life we have these moments every day where we could choose the instant gratification over the future blessing. But please don't rush into a relationship just to be married. Wait for God's blessing. Don't sell your soul for some job. Wait for God's blessing in whatever form that might be in. Don't look into someone else's marriage for your spouse. You wait for God's blessing. Don't stoop down to the level of your critics or your haters. You wait for God's blessing. Because the list of instant gratification moments is infinite. It's ever-changing, day in and day out. Don't sacrifice God's future blessing for instant gratification. Because the truth is that God's long-term blessing will always outweigh the short-term gratification of this world every time. And the reason is because this world is broken and it can't give you what it's selling you. To modify the famous Top Gun line, the world's ego is writing checks that its body can't cash. And when we go to the world and want it to pay up for all the promises it said it would have for us, do you know it's bankrupt? And all of this comes back to timing. We don't think that God is running on our time, and so the instant looks so much more satisfying than the delayed. But the truth is that God's timing will always be different than what we expect. It just will be. And it's because he's God, and we're not. God knows what we need, when the time is right for him to act. But by blowing through the waiting to get to what we want now, we miss on the formative process that grows us closer to God. It's through the waiting. It's through the wilderness that we know God more and more, that we rely on God more and more. Our faith, it grows as we wait. If we never had to wait or walk through the wilderness, we wouldn't need faith, because guys, faith requires waiting, and waiting results in blessing. David waited, didn't act on the instant gratification of eliminating Saul. He waited, and he was blessed, not just with power and prestige and the king, which we'll talk about next week, but did you know that he was also blessed with the eventual savior of the world, Jesus Christ, coming through his bloodline? David is the proof that a heart beating for God doesn't sacrifice God's future blessing for instant gratification. The beauty of that is that in the waiting is where we meet God more. So this week, a few things that you should do. I skip so much in these chapters, you won't even believe it, but you can read it for yourself. 1 Samuel chapter 17 through 26. Read that, get some popcorn. It is so good, and dive into God's word this week. But I want you to ask number two, what happens to your heart in the wilderness? What happens? And how can this week you and I say no to instant gratification to wait for the future blessing of God? I love that we take communion each week. And the reason that this is so important is because it reminds us that Jesus didn't take the instant gratification of calling down angels to crush all of his foes, or to take out all the guards, or take out Pilate and all the things that were untrue about him in that moment of crucifixion. But instead, he took on the cross for us. He waited because he knew that there was an eternal blessing that was going to come. Not for him, but for us. And so he showed us through the waiting of taking on the pain of the wilderness, even himself going through the wilderness. He took that on for us so that we could one day receive the blessing he wanted to give us. He said no to the immediate so we could say yes to the eternal. And so it's through this communion that we remember that this bread that you have on the top here, it represents Jesus' body that was broken on that cross for you and for me. The bread of life broken for you and for me. We'll take and eat in remembrance of him. And this juice represents the shed blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins so we can be made whole, so we could have blessing. Take and drink in remembrance of Jesus. And so, before we worship, I'll just remind you that you're going to be getting a card on the way out, a memory verse card for this week. And we're going to worship here in a second, but I want you to remember Romans 8:18. Paul says, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Future blessing. Future blessing. Found only in Jesus. So as we worship and as we sing, my encouragement to you is to remember why we're singing. It's for Jesus and Jesus alone. To worship him for the future blessing he offers us. Heavenly Father, we come before you now. And we are so humbled at what you've done for us. We ask, Father, that you would come into our lives, that you would encourage us, you would strengthen us, you would convict us, that in the wilderness, in the waiting, Father, that we get to know you more. And I pray, Father, that you would be with us in this moment of worship, that we would sing to you, we would cry out to you, and we would want to hear your heartbeat in our chest. We trust you, Jesus, that you will do that. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sins, for giving us grace. May we worship you for that sacrifice you made now. In your name we pray. Amen. Stand to your feet. Let's worship Jesus together now.
Yeah.
still in control.
Your love.
adopt.